Hello everyone. My name is Harald Kleiner and I'm an Associate Professor at the University of New South Wales in the School of Engineering and Technology. In a previous video, I introduced a few methods to make the invisible visible, or more specifically, to look at flows that you could not see with the naked eye. And today I would like to show you a few applications of these techniques. One of the big topics in aerodynamics is the control of drag. In particular, most likely to reduce the drag. If you have a blunt object like this cylinder, then this will generate a fairly large drag, in particular in supersonic flow when there will be a very massive bow shock established in front of this cylinder with a large pressure increase, and that in turn leads to a very large amount of drag. So what can we do in order to reduce this drag? If we cannot change the shape as such, what we could do is we could add a component to this object in the form of such a spike. A spike is simply a sting that you attach to the front surface. So this becomes this. The idea is that this spike pierces through the strong bow shock that sits in front of our blunt cylinder and converts it into a conical shock, which is much weaker and has a much lower pressure increase, and therefore the drag will be reduced. This idea was already introduced several decades ago, and in principle it's pretty good, except that it only works for a very limited number of spike lengths and also geometries. You also have to be very careful about the tip, the shape, the tip of this spike. So for a large number of spike lengths and tip shapes, you get very unstable flows, which reduces the usefulness of the spike. When we looked at this problem, we realized that almost all of the experimental tests on this subject have been conducted in supersonic tunnels, where, like here, you would put a model onto a sting and let the air flow over it. And one question that we asked ourselves was, what if we had a model that has no sting or strings attached and is flying through quiescent air? Would we see the same kind of instabilities? So for this, we went to a different test facility that we have here on campus, a so-called light gas gun. This light gas gun is capable of launching projectiles, such as those, to speeds of up to 4.5 kilometers per second. We didn't really have to go that fast for our tests, but what we could do is we could reproduce the flow conditions of the supersonic tunnel. So these models, which are scale models of the models in the supersonic tunnel, were launched at the same Mach number and Reynolds number that the model would experience in the supersonic tunnel. And then we observed the flow together with some visualization techniques and a high-speed camera. And here are some results. In order to compare the footage we got in the light gas gun to what we got in the supersonic tunnel, we immobilized the footage from the light gas gun so that we can put these two clips side by side. And there we can see that the flow patterns that we get in both cases are virtually identical. In fact, the Struhal number, which is the non-dimensional frequency of the oscillation, as well as the shock motion amplitude in both cases, are equal within measurement accuracy. This shows that the instabilities that we are observing are not a function of the test facility, but most certainly they are only caused by the shape of your flying object and the speed at which it is moving. This example illustrates how important and useful visualization is in the investigation of a fluids problem. One of my colleagues, Gary Settles, a professor emeritus of Penn State University in the US, once said that visualization should ideally always be the first step in a fluid mechanics investigation. Imagine that you want to design an aircraft. One very important aspect is that after you have done the initial design, you would like to know whether the flow field around your aircraft is really what you expect it to be, or whether you or not you have flow interactions happening around the aircraft shape that you may not have expected or that may not have been revealed in the initial calculations. We follow this idea in our aircraft design course. where we ask the students to come up with a design, then 3D print a model, and then we put that model into our wind tunnel and see if the flow pattern is corresponding to what the students expected it to be. And in addition, we also measure the drag. We can also come up with a modular design in which we can determine which component of the aircraft adds how much to the overall drag. We start with a fuselage like this. We then add a wing. And finally, we add a tail. And for each of those three configurations, we determine the drag coefficient. That will allow us how to determine how much drag is added by the addition of the wing and how much by the addition of the tail. And if we change the shapes of these added components, we can come up with a fairly complete parameter study. I already mentioned in the previous video that we don't have to restrict those kind of investigations to existing aircraft, but that we can also look at aircraft or spacecraft from fiction and see how they would fare, how well would they fly if they actually existed. Back in the late 70s and 80s, there was a big debate which of those two iconic spacecraft was better. Was it the X-Wing from Star Wars or the Viper from Battlestar Galactica? Now, we have to keep in mind that both of those craft have been seen in the movies and on TV to be capable of landing on a planet with an atmosphere, which means that they should also be suitable for atmospheric flight. And that is actually the only aspect we can investigate in our facility. So I don't want to weigh in with this in this debate which of those two is the better craft in terms of atmospheric flight, but have a look at the visualization results and I'll leave it to your judgment which of those two will likely have the lower drag in when it flies through an atmosphere. Here we got another sci-fi vehicle from the past, a very interesting spacecraft design that featured in Buck Rogers in the 25th century. That is the Starfighter, and the craft that was seen in the movie and in the TV series looked a bit like this. When a toy manufacturer decided to come up with a die-cast model, they modified the design and they added this bar here in front of the two pointy tips. Now, most people think that this was done entirely for safety reasons, because those two tips here can certainly be a hazard if this model is being played with. But I wanted to have a closer look at this and check whether there might have been other reasons for adding this bar in this design. And if you look at the visualizations, you will find out that the two pointy tips create two shock waves that focus somewhere very close to the front of the body. That could be very dangerous for the craft if it were to fly through an atmosphere. And likewise, if you know what's happening when any craft sort of enters the atmosphere, you would know that the temperatures at the tips here would become very, very high, so that these tips could easily melt. And both of those features would be avoided by adding the bar. So maybe the designers of this die-cast aircraft knew a bit more about aerodynamics than is commonly believed. I hope that I could show with these examples that these kind of visualizations can not only contribute to science and technology, but they can also be quite entertaining and fun. In fact, what you can do with these kind of tests is really only limited by your imagination, the size of your test section, possibly your budget, and occasionally the material properties of your model.